Hey, good evening. Welcome to 10 Shades of Chocolate. That's when y'all clap again. Before we go any further, I want to thank my friend and the owner of this wonderful establishment, Let Them Eat Chocolate, for having us here. Skip around. Some talented motherfuckers get ready to do it. I like to use, now, if anybody is offended, let me apologize, I like using the word motherfucker. It's just my dad, it's Father's Day tomorrow, my dad was a proponent of the word motherfucker. He would say, Bobo, did you do your homework, motherfucker? And I was like, Dad, what? Oh, yeah. Okay, motherfucker. Good job. It would always end, and this was, I was a young lad, and so it kind of stuck with me, but I was temperate. I don't want to offend too much.
Not too much.
Simple rules before I introduce myself. Simple rules. If you have to hold a conversation with someone, this is how it should sound. Maybe a little lower. Good. Okay? If you need to text somebody, we don't need to hit the typewriter text, do it real quick because some things happen, some of y'all are kids, clarification, but if you do that, boom, be done with it, okay? Number three, make sure you provide patrons to this wonderful establishment. I recommend peanut butter and chocolate gelato. This is my recommendation. It's magnificent. Get you a latte, buy your water, buy a juice, buy something. See, I said the emphasis, something.
All right.
We got books on sale back there. There's complimentary wine provided by our, what are you, like, producer of the show? Like, that thing is just a thing. Cotton Campbell, please just give a round of applause. Right now, and mean that shit.
I try to make them chocolate themed, into a little chapter about Poetic Shades of Chocolate. Because you kind of got the same colors with your jacket, you're going to get this copy, and then I'd like you to give copies to whoever wants to have a copy.
All right.
So you can have copies. And there's another announcement. I am releasing a book on my birthday, which is Monday, which I'm going to email for and grab it, which is talking about the year of writing that I've done. And this is a proof copy of a year-long journey, and it has these poems in it because these are things from the past year as well. I've got one proof copy in my hand, $10 if somebody wants it. So I'm done with that announcement. Now, if I'm raising, now I get to sit. The first three pieces I'm going to do are going to be relationship themed, and then I'm going to go into chocolate. And I think we need some background music for this, just so that everybody knows. The music you're going to hear is Sam. Everybody's talking very loudly.
Excuse me. Shut the fuck up. I got the phone up here. I apologize.
Thank you. He
says what I feel.
I'm sorry. Play music in the background, and it's sampled from Angelo Badalamenti from the soundtrack from Fire Walk With Me. It's from a track called Real Indication. It's just sampled stuff. It's just going to run in the background of this whole performance, and I hope it's tolerable.
Got it.
Do I have volume? Just something quiet in the background. I know I'm going to have a seat and start reading. We hadn't dated that long, or we're not that close. And he brought me to his bedroom, sat me down on his bed, and said he had something to show me. My legs are now hanging over the side of the bed, and he says, "Hold on a minute." And then he gets on his knees. And I'm thinking, what does he want to show me? But then while he's on his knees, he reaches under the bed. I'm sitting on this bed now. My legs are dangling over the edge, and I couldn't see what he was doing until he got up off of the floor, and he placed the black object on the bed. "What is this?" I ask. "They're knee pads," he answered. So he's brought me to his bedroom. I'm sitting on his bed, and he's showing me knee pads. There was no explanation. He just brought me to his bed to show me knee pads. And so my mind goes into overdrive. Why did he bring me in here to show me these? I mean, we're not that close. We hadn't dated that long, but is this something he needs for some sort of sexual act? I mean, is he concerned about my spring knees if I'm getting him off? My eyes were like saucers, and all I could ask was, "What are these for?" He started to grin. "I just got rollerblades," he answered, which I hadn't seen and didn't know. But as I said, we hadn't dated that long. We're not that close. So all I could think when he brought me to his bedroom and showed me this new gear that he kept under his bed, all I thought was that this was the most bizarre way to ask someone for the first time for safe sex. I'm going to stand for the rest of these. Been trying to describe them to my friends. I mean, it was such a red-hot relationship. Sometimes our love would burn so bright, and sometimes it would seem like we're nothing. Because now I figured them out, and now it all makes sense. He was a cigarette. Our time together was so short, and like those nicotine sticks, it burned out too fast. When he was getting me all hot and bothered, I'd take a deep breath, suck in some oxygen to flame the fire between us, and he glowed with a red-hot intensity. But whenever he got bored with me, he just made ashes out of our relationship, and all that was left was a smoke trail and a smell I couldn't quite name in the air. Everyone was telling me he was no good, but I didn't know better. I couldn't help it. I was intoxicated, but now that he's gone, I wonder how much pain this affair has caused. I want to be free. many times, but it was like he had a spell over me. I was an addict, and I just sucked him in, adding fuel to the fire that was once our love. When I wake up every morning, unlike everyone else, I rip the blankets off of me because I'm boiling hot. Been trying to figure out why. When I wake up every morning alone, I wonder if my missing you manifests itself by leaving me tossing and turning in my dreams until I wake up in a sweat. These must be my red-hot thoughts percolating up inside of me in the middle of the night, leaving me fuming in the morning. This is what I wonder. Is this what being without you makes me do? I think I run to you all night long. When I go to bed at night after a day without you, I'm ice cold. But my brain spends hours throughout the night in my sleep thinking about us together, thinking about trying to find you. It spends hours thinking about what being without you means. And I wake up like I do every morning after feeling like I've mentally run a marathon. And I go about my day alone. Life makes me cold again. And I wonder what it takes to get back to you again. Enough of the new relationship ones. I'm going to do things about chocolate. None of them relate. They're about every topic under the sun. I'm just going to read things that relate to chocolate. Ready? I'd say I wasn't pampered, but when I was in grade school, kids would buy for their school lunches either cartons of milk or cartons of chocolate milk. And I didn't like milk, but I loved chocolate, so I always drank chocolate milk. But I told Mom that the chocolate milk from the school cartons was like granulated. It didn't taste right. So Mom, every day before school, would put the chocolate product PDQ into a little pouch wrapped in tin foil so that I could mix chocolate PDQ in my regular milk. She did this so I could have chocolate milk just the way I want. Saw a short, larger woman today. It kind of looked like she was once squashed by one of those cartoon anvils. Well, this woman walked by. I watched her ankles. They reminded me of cascading rolls of melted marshmallow. Think of an Applebee's dessert chocolate fountain. And I suddenly craved a roaring fire and melted chocolates over s'mores. I just heard that a grandmother was charged with murdering her granddaughter. You see, she caught the 9-year-old girl eating chocolates. So to punish her, she made her carry a bunch of firewood in both arms as she ran back and forth in her backyard. Without even giving her water, her granddaughter died of cardiac arrest and dehydration. I'm sorry. I don't study the masters. I just study the disasters as I eat my dark chocolates and observe. By the way, the master's disaster line is a quote from Sidia. Once I was flying to New Orleans with a huge as a button girl from Kentucky. She was a riot to hang around with, and she was deathly afraid of flying. And I knew her fear. So for this flight, back before 9/11, I brought to the airport a 32-ounce cup of hot chocolate and peppermint schnapps. So she said she was afraid, and I told her to have some drink. I've flown with friends afraid of heights, I've flown to jump out of airplanes. I've even trained and piloted an airplane. I've flown to see the Aurora Borealis in Alaska. Wait, I've even seen the Aurora Borealis from above, from my window, over Greenland in the middle of the night. It's amazing how flying lets you see so much of the world. But I have to admit, it's an added bonus when you can sip on hot chocolates before you take off to the sky. All right, go. Thank you very much, Chris. I've got one, and this is my most recent poem in this thing, and of course, it's about yum yum. This is called Empty Chocolates. Come to me. I should be loved. I used to say what change I could when I was little, and I'd ride my bike to the Plush Horse Ice Cream Parlor to get a scoop of their chocolate chip ice cream. That's chocolate ice cream with chocolate chips in it. But once I got a job there, I discovered they were still old-fashioned there. Only males were hired to scoop ice cream. But it was now under new management, and a brother of the owner of Dove Chocolates took it over, and I was hired to work with a brand new chocolate candy counter. So now, for the first time, this ice cream parlor was open year-round, and I got to sell chocolates there. So, in the winter, it's safe to say that it wasn't very busy. I was there once, so I was there in the winter, and I was there to sell chocolates to no one, and I'm alongside the designated male ice cream scooper. Now, I couldn't get away with eating the individual chocolates for sale there. They keep track of their inventory. But the ice cream that made in the back room, that was harder to keep track of. So every night in the winter, I'd make myself a 24-ounce chocolate chip shake, out of chocolate ice cream with chocolate chips, and with them, added fudge, of course. But one Tuesday night in February, I was sitting in a chair behind my counter with my precious chocolate ice cream, chocolate chip shake, and fudge in my hand. And my shake was there, and the side door opened right in front of my counter. And that's when, lo and behold, the owner actually walked through the front door. So I make this mad dash, and I stash my shake under the counter, and I stand at attention. "Hello, sir, how are you?" I asked. And he just grumbled, mumbled, he was fine, and he walked to the back office. Phew, that was a close call there. But another day, I worked with the boss. When deliveries were dropped off, I picked up one of the larger boxes, and the owner stopped me. "Wait, that's heavy. You shouldn't carry that." And I laughed, explaining that I carry 50-pound salt blocks from our water stoppers that I'm totally fine. And I think maybe him seeing that women can't stand up for themselves made it okay in the heat of summer when the lines were out the door for ice cream to leave me that empty chocolate counter and be the first girl ever there to scoop ice cream with the big boys. Looking back, you may say I'm a feminist pioneer for being the first female to scoop ice cream there. But when I look back, I don't see it that way. I just remember homemade chocolate ice cream with chocolate chips, molasses bits, and added fudge, and that, my friends, was whipped into the most perfect shake, no matter which gender was making it for you.